Thank you, guys.
Just one second.
You need a little more?
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Senator Jim Seward. I chair the Insurance Committee in the Senate, and I want to welcome everyone for coming here this morning for our flood insurance roundtable. And I'm hosting today with my colleague, Senator John Bonasek, whose district was also greatly impacted with the storms of the last August and September. And we're delighted that also Senator Jack Martins has joined us here at the table. We're expecting Senator Larkin as well as Senator Breslin. And a former colleague of ours, formerly in the State Assembly, Congressman Paul Tonko. Paul, thank you for being here. And we're delighted that our superintendent of the Department of Financial Services, Superintendent Ben Lawski, is with us here today as well. And I want to say to the department and to Ben in particular, we're very, very appreciative of your efforts and being right there on the scene. I know together we went in some cases door to door.
A lot of mud.
In some communities just following the storms, and you've been a great help, and you and the department. Now, in the wake of the devastation from both Hurricane Irene and Tropical Storm Lee, we have heard many complaints and concerns from homeowners who actually had purchased the flood insurance through the NFIP, the National Flood Insurance Program. And as we all know, traditional homeowners insurance does not cover flooding. And the only way to obtain this coverage is through the NFIP. And those who purchased flood insurance policies thought they were doing the right thing, and expected that they would be fully covered in the event that a flooding situation occurred. But unfortunately, this did not turn out to be the case for far too many people. Homeowners have faced a number of obstacles during the claims process, which has been painful and oftentimes traumatic, and that's following a painful and traumatic flood event as well. So in addition, there have been a fair amount of confusion and misinformation out there regarding the process and how the NFIP is administered here in New York. I mean, who is responsible? Who has oversight? The feds, the write-your-own carriers? What role does the state play? It seems that, at least at the beginning, everyone was pointing their fingers at each other, and homeowners, far too many, were left stuck in the middle. And so in light of these concerns, Senator Bonasek, myself, and the other Senate members here today, we thought it prudent to get all parties around the table to sort out some of these issues, clear up confusion, get the correct information out there on the table, and possibly and hopefully some steps that can be taken to improve the process for the benefit of our constituents, the people of the state of New York and across the country, for that matter. We also hope to, identify some of these solutions and changes so that, obviously, the intent is that some of these problems do not occur in the future. So before we open our general discussion, have everyone introduce themselves, I'd like to ask if Senator Bonasek and other members, if they would also like to make a few opening comments.
First of all, good morning. Thank you, Jim, for co-hosting this today. Thank you all for coming. By the way, Mr. Greenfield, I like your tie.
Save me
you
a
have very good taste.
Getting in the spirit.
We're selling the Irish today, tonight.
I wear green in my name all year.
Senator Libous's district, Senator Seward's district, and my district got devastated with Hurricane Irene and Lee. They're really not rich districts. They're hardworking, blue-collar people that just don't have much of a tax base, the municipalities. And what we experienced, the feedback from the people that are hurting, is that there was a lot of course, things. Go see FEMA, go see your insurance company. And the reality is the people that did not have insurance did better in getting immediate relief from FEMA than people that had insurance or were underinsured. They got caught in the confusion of the process. And there were times where insurance agents or inspectors were told took 8 to 10 weeks before they even visited the damage sites. So we're here not to blame anybody, but God forbid if we get hit again anywhere in the state, we will have a process that's clear, will be coordinated with federal, state roles, the roles of the insurance company, and maybe we can help our people faster in the future. So we thank you all for being here.
Thank you, Senator. Senator Martins?
Thank you. I want to thank Senator Seward for bringing us all together. I represent an area in southeast New York State, Long Island, and certainly we were as concerned with the effects of this storm as anyone else. Original estimates were that the storm would hit us, and certainly we are concerned year in and year out when it comes to the potential for storms and the impacts on our homeowners and businesses on Long Island. So this is an important topic for all of New York State, and certainly we understand the impacts to certain regions of the state given storms that we had this year, but it's an important issue. I appreciate the fact that our insurance, Senate Insurance Committee, has taken a lead on this, and I appreciate the fact that you're here because it is an important dialogue, and certainly not only to address the issues that came up this year, but also hopefully prevent those issues from replicating themselves in future years as well. So I'm looking forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator, and Congressman Tonko. I know you're, because we share Schoharie County, and I know even in addition to Schoharie, other parts of your district were
right.
Severely impacted with the floods.
Right. Thank you, Senator, for the opportunity to join with you today and with Senator Bonsnick, with whom I served, and your colleagues also. Superintendent Ben Lasky, thank you for reaching out. I know we've interacted, our office, with yours. We appreciate the help in the aftermath of discussion that we had at a community-wide town hall a few weeks back. And the pain continues to impact the people of the district that I represent. We have seen, and Bill Cherry can tell you as treasurer, that people are really making a valiant effort to come back. And Marty Schwartzman has been awesome also to have you out into the district, Marty. When you see it, when you hear the pain right from the people who are experiencing it, it means a lot. But it is troubling that so much of this effort has been impacting people in what appears to be an unnecessary way. At times it's turned into an exercise of semantics, sometimes a battle over semantics. Was it a hurricane or a flood? I don't know. I have 7 feet of water in my business. You tell me. But I've paid for 25 years, and now when I first draw down on a policy, I'm having heartache instead of help. Not a pretty picture. Not an acceptable outcome. And so, you know, many people are advising. They've seen what's happened here. I have people who have had numerous people to come over and visit and to do the adjusting. And they said, you know, there's no sense of continuity. There's delays. Is delay equaling money? That's what they're asking me. Unacceptable. Even when agreements are made, payments are coming in far too late. They're asking if we can have a not-to-exceed response time, making it more restrictive, making more pressure on the system, on the players. If you have insurance, you believe you should collect, especially when you had such inordinate circumstances. Should there be a not-to-exceed response time for payments to begin after the flood loss documents have been produced? Should there be a not-to-exceed response time for payment in full for all the dollars due them? Should there be a not-to-exceed number of insurance adjusters per insured? I kept seeing new faces. They kept hearing delays in the process. You know, what's it all about? Unacceptable outcomes. As people look for help in every dimension, and they're getting it, volunteer groups that are producing great things, faith community efforts that are coming forward, neighbors helping neighbors, drawing down funds from government however we can, and it's still not enough. So to get more heartache unnecessarily is what I think is compelling a lot of people to ask for a lot more demands placed upon the system so that there's a government overview, perhaps policy that's initiated that puts more guidelines into it. Make certain that there are bookends here that have to be followed and adhered to so that we can have acceptable outcomes. It is tough to witness. And so I appreciate the opportunity to be here today to hear what everyone has to say and to join in the dialogue. Unfortunately, I have to leave around 11:30, so I apologize in advance for that. But Sean Chartel, who is our district director, is in the audience, and he'll continue to take notes.
Take your seat. Thank you, Congressman. Before we go around the table, I would like to call on our superintendent, Ben Lawski. Superintendent?
This is working. Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman, my chairman. I think this is just absolutely essential that we're doing this today, and thank you to Senator Bonasik, Senator Martins, and the congressman. I've obviously spent a fair amount of time working with all of you in these last few months, but especially the chairman. We had many, many days on the ground and all over your district and other areas in very tough circumstances, and I think we were dressed differently than we are now, but it's those moments and efforts, I think, that really define our elected officials, and I think for you and for all of the officials here today, the excellent response we had, after the storms in August were just outstanding. That said, it's great we're doing this today because I think there are many, many lessons we can learn and have learned, continue to learn about how to do this better. You have a governor, I can tell you, who wants his administration to be better at disaster preparedness and emergency response, really, than we ever have been before, and wants his administration to really lead the nation in those things. And he's hired a guy named Jerry Hauer, Department of Homeland Security. We're now spending a lot of time in locked rooms with Jerry Hauer, all the cabinet officials getting ready for the next disaster, whatever it may be, and I think it's fair to say that there will be more of these, and there will be more storms, and there will be other problems our state will face, and this governor is definitely committed to making sure we are absolutely ready for that and prepared. Insurance is key, especially in the, not the immediate aftermath of a disaster, but shortly thereafter. I can tell you that from our numbers at the department, We estimate the industry paid about $550 million in claims. $400 million of that was homeowners. About $150 million of that was flood insurance. And I think that points up an obvious conclusion we all learned, but I'll say it anyway. Not enough people in the state of New York have flood insurance, and we need to figure out why and change that. I think we can always do a better job of coordinating. I'm talking to myself now at the department with FEMA and the National Flood Insurance Program to make our responsiveness and our interactions with them better and more impactful, and I will do that. And lastly, I think we learned that maybe the most important thing after a storm and or after a disaster from a governmental point of view is just showing up and doing our jobs to the best of our ability and getting on the ground and understanding what people are really experiencing. It's what the congressman pointed out. You can ask the questions in an office of whose jurisdiction is this and whose jurisdiction is that and who's responsible for this and that. But at the end of the day, when you show up in the neighborhood and people are standing there saying, I have 7 feet of water in my building, what are you going to do about it? That I think really changes the way we look at these issues. So we're going to continue with the department to do the absolutely best we can do. Marty Schwartzman, who's here with me today, is really the expert in our department on this issue and so many other issues that we deal with. He's been with the department 32 years. He worked harder than anyone after the storms this summer, and I want to thank him personally, but also let you know that he's committed to this issue and staying on this issue, and he's really our point person and will continue to be. So I thank him for that. And just looking forward to working through all the various issues we have today and having a great dialogue, not only amongst ourselves, but with the industry. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Superintendent. Why don't we'll go around the table at this point in time. Everyone introduce themselves and your role in terms of being here, and if you'd like to make a minute or so a statement at the beginning, that's fine. Then we'll get into a series of questions and open discussion. We'll start with you, Marty, senior advisor.
Marty Schwartzman, senior advisor to the Superintendent, Department of Financial Services.
I'm Seamus Leary. I'm the emergency manager for Orange County.
Dave Starkweather, Preferred Mutual Insurance Company in Shenango County.
I'm Bill Oliver with the Partners Insurance in Vestal, New York. I have offices in Broome and Pleasant counties, and I'm also here as the representative for the Independent Insurance Agents and Brokers of New York.
Jeff Greenfield, the real Jeff Greenfield, not the one on CBS News. I'm an independent agent for past president of the Professional Insurance Agents of New York. And Chairman Seward, thank you for bringing us all together here. And we have a number of issues that we want to call to the attention of the regulators as well as the senators. It's a federal FEMA program, but it becomes a New York problem. Southwest Nassau, where my agency is, we still have claims that aren't settled, and we've had multiple problems with the issue of multiple adjusters, and we want to speak to that issue later on.
Mark Greigel, New York Central Mutual. Paul Tracy, Claim Director for Allstate Insurance Company. Appreciate the opportunity to be here, Senator.
Wakas Tarani, Regional Counsel, Allstate Insurance Company.
Don Griffin with PCI. Appreciate the opportunity to be here. I handle the flood issues for our trade association, as well as I have the distinction of working with an industry group, Write Your Own Flood Insurance Coalition, that works on the flood issues in the Capitol.
Hi, I'm Patty Templeton Jones. I'm the Chief Operating Officer from Fidelity National Insurance, and I handle all operations for Fidelity in the flood arena.
I'm Neil Connolly. I'm the President of WRM. We acquired Fidelity in November, but we're on the ground at the time of the storm, and we're down in Uniondale, Senator, in your district. Fidelity is the largest WIO company in the country, but we only have a small percentage of the New York market, although we did have 1,500 claims during the storm.
I'm Karen Christian, Supervisory Insurance Examiner at FEMA.
And Jordan Freed, I am the Associate Chief Counsel for the Federal Insurance and Mitigation Administration, which is a component of FEMA and has responsibility over the flood insurance program. I do want to say a few things. We've reached out to the New York State Insurance Office, and as well as the other offices in areas that were impacted by Irene and Lee after the storm. Many of these states, and New York, traditionally is not a huge state with a lot of NFIP interaction. If we were Louisiana, Mississippi, there's areas that see us a lot more. And our management, our leadership recognized that and did try to reach out to try to educate the people who would be working with the people on the ground as to the nature of our program early on. And I also do want to emphasize that we run a national program, which is much more than an insurance program, that part of it is the intent of the program, the intent of the statute is to involve local communities in flood mitigation and trying to prevent damage before it happens. And we combine the sale of insurance, which in many cases is subsidized by the federal government, with a program that encourages local communities to implement local ordinances that reduce the risk of flood. And we also tie that with various grant programs and mitigation measures, really with the intent of over a period of time trying to reduce our nation's risk of flood. So thank you. I appreciate being here.
Yes, my name is Ron Papa, and I'm the president of NFA National Fire Adjustment. We're public insurance adjusters. We're licensed by the insurance department to represent insureds when they have insurance claims. We're in our fourth generation. My daughter, Jody, is here with me, and one of my daughters who works for us is in Massapequa. I'm also a past president of our national association and currently a director of the New York Association.
My name is Bill Cherry. I'm the Schoharie County Treasurer and also an affected homeowner.
Great. Well, thank you all for being here. I think before we get into some other issues, I'd just like to just get on the table and just to clarify for everyone in terms of the jurisdictional issue. I know at the outset there was some degree of confusion in terms of what role, you know, our state regulator has when it comes to the NFIP program, and also with the, as it relates to the write your own carriers, those carriers that are writing for the NFIP here in New York, and in terms of unfair business practices and the other normal regulatory functions that our department has. I would say between FEMA and you, Mr. Superintendent, can you get that out there in terms of has that been clarified and once and for all in terms of that jurisdictional issue?
I think it has, if I can. We put out a circular letter, I forget which month it was, about New York law's role vis-a-vis the National Flood Insurance Program, and I think we subsequently had a very productive meeting with FEMA. They came to New York, and we sat down. And, you know, I think as Mr. Freed pointed out, they are a national program. This isn't just about New York. And they made clear soon thereafter in some guidance that FEMA put out that state regulators play a role. It is a national flood insurance program and has the word national. That's what the N stands for. But at the same time, the state plays a role. And I think we did work that all out. So, you know, we do have a statute, I think it's 3444, mm-hmm. which has various requirements that I'm sure the industry is well aware of. And those are certainly consistent with the same, very similar to, frankly, many of the requirements in the NFIP regs. And I think it's now clear, not only in our state, but in all the states, that insurers need to abide by those state rules, but at the same time, it is a national program, you know, ultimately, that's being administered. And so we're working together. We have good communication, and I feel good about that now.
Yeah, sure, and I'll reiterate that. We came up and we talked with Marty, who everybody's loving Marty today. So and we really clarified a lot of things. and I think we've been working pretty closely together. FEMA does have internal administrative processes that will work with people who have claims issues. We recognize, of course, there's going to be disputes as we move through the process. And we have an internal appeal process that we worked with Marty to explain sort of how that works, and to really encourage people to take advantage of that. We are happy to see state regulators. We recognize that you know, you're working with your citizens on the ground, and they're also our insureds. And when it comes to really interpreting what the program means and complying with the federal requirements, we do need to work with the federal government. And one concern that I want to relay is to make sure that individuals in reaching out to a state regulator aren't losing their federal rights, because there are rights to bring suit, rights to appeals and all that sort of that don't necessarily work hand in hand with the state investigations and remedies. But I do think we've been working pretty well together since some early sort of rough spots. Yeah.
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Any other comments on this particular point?
On this issue, I applaud the superintendent his first week in office on hitting this issue head on. Sorry it happened to you. We have some issues with some of our member agents that there is no state law protection for cancellation of contracts, as well as cancellation provisions to the insured. That is an issue that hopefully, and I'll go into greater detail with Marty and I'll get to you, we had some issues with one carrier with respect to their claims settlement practices, and our contract was canceled with 30 days notice, leaving us in a lurch with respect to our insured.
Thank you.
At this point, we do want this to be an open discussion and free flow of talk here, but I would like to kick that off to ask Bill Cherry, who's our Schoharie County treasurer, and, just as pertinent to today's discussion, he's an affected homeowner in the village of Schoharie. And Bill, I'd like to ask you just to kind of lay out your experience as a homeowner and one who would purchase the National Flood Insurance.
Thank you. Thank you, Senator Seward. I'll be glad to do that. And thank you to yourself and Senator Bonasek and Congressman Tonko, especially the way you described the situation. It's clear that you're all in tune with your constituents, because that sums up exactly kind of the feelings that we have. Many folks have a feeling of desperation, and you think insurance is going to cover you, and sometimes that's not the case. In my case, my wife and I had renovated a big Center Hall colonial on Main Street in the village of Schoharie, raised our five kids there, and a beautiful home that was essentially our, you know, the sum of our assets. That was our retirement asset. And we were not in a flood zone, but after watching, we watched an HBO documentary about Hurricane Katrina. After that struck New Orleans, and we turned to each other almost at the same time after that and said, you know, we live downstream from the Gilboa Dam, holding back the Gilboa Reservoir. Can't imagine anything like this could ever happen, but what if that dam ever broke loose, that water came down the valley? I mean, this, our house is really our only asset, so we better protect it. So we did get national flood insurance coverage, even though we weren't in a floodplain. We never thought we would need it. We thought it was like most insurances. It's, you're insuring that just in the worst case scenario. But in this case, the dam did not give way, but the floodwaters were so excessive from Hurricane Irene, 15 inches of rain in Senator Bonasek's area that comes downstream, went over that Gilboa Dam and around that Gilboa Dam, and eventually found its way into the village of Schoharie. So our house was, we were all forced evacuation, and our house was destroyed in the flooding. It's still standing, but it's empty, it's gutted, foundation walls collapsed, and unlivable at this point. We're in an apartment. My experience regarding the flood insurance, I unfortunately don't have anything good to say. There's very well-meaning people in the insurance industry that go out of their way to try to help folks, but we had a, my family had a terrible time with the flood insurance. First of all, we did write to NFIP, this was in early November, laying out some of our, the problems we were having, and we didn't even receive an answer back. I wrote to NFIP with all of our information, the claim number, and detailing the problems we were having. To date, I haven't gotten a phone call or a letter from NFIP. Allstate was the insurance company that was the administrator of our NFIP policy. We personally experienced just what Senator Seward mentioned, the sort of a musical chairs of adjusters. I stopped counting at six. There were a couple more than that. If I had to guess, it was more like eight or nine, but I stopped counting at six. And what happened to us was you would work with an adjuster either in person or an adjuster that was removed from our area. I think Mobile, Alabama, if I remember, was where a couple of them were from. So you're doing it by phone and email. Anyway, you'd work with an adjuster and get to what felt like almost the point to you had satisfied their request. It was either for photos or proof of that you own some content or whatever the thing may be. One of the examples I'll give you is I had a hearing aid, and one of the Allstate adjusters led us to believe that if we could just prove that I had a hearing aid, that was going to be the final hurdle, because obviously the inside of the house was gutted. Everything was gone. It was destroyed. So I had to, you know, kind of go to the place where I had the hearing aid, get a letter from them saying, yes, you bought a hearing aid from us. I submitted that to Allstate, thinking, okay, it's embarrassing and it's kind of demoralizing, but it's the last hurdle. And as soon as I did that, that adjuster was no longer assigned to the case, and then a new adjuster, and you start all over. And it was always something different. It was either photos that they needed or proof of something. One of the things was carpeting. That was a different adjuster. In their settlement offer, they had assigned a value of $1.95 a square foot to the wall-to-wall carpeting that we had in our house. And this was, maybe somebody can buy carpeting for $1.99, I don't know, but certainly we didn't. And we had high quality, you know, $30 a square foot carpeting plus installed, and it had only been in for about a year. So we had to go back to the carpet place and once again get a copy of, because everything that we had was gone, you know, the records, the receipts, it's all gone. You're starting from zero. So I had to go back to the carpet place, get proof that we had put in wall-to-wall carpeting and that it was, in fact, $30 a square yard, which is exactly what I had said. I hadn't inflated it or anything. And then that adjuster was gone, and it was somebody else. So it was a brutal, bruising process. The final straw for me was Allstate had hired a subcontractor with an engineer to come and do a structural review of the house. Now, mind you, when you're standing in this gutted house and you go down into the basement, the basement wall is collapsed. This house was built in 1850, big, beautiful center hall colonial, and the basement walls were 2 feet thick. I mean, it was a solid, you know, I thought that house would be there forever. The floodwaters pushed in that basement wall till it was, when you were down in the basement, it was a cascading rubble. I mean, it was at a 45-degree angle, and you could look up and see sky. So that the entire side was pushed in. Of course, we pointed that out to the Allstate engineer. I mean, that was critical. There's nothing holding up. It was about an 18-foot section with no support. We waited about between two and three months to get that report. Allstate wouldn't give us a copy of it. We finally had to I think we foiled Allstate, if I remember, to get a copy of the engineering report. And the engineering report said that there was no structural damage to the house, despite the fact that I had stood next to the guy and pointed this out. So this has taken us all through, you know, October, November, December. We went and hired our own private engineer, Lamont Engineers in Cobleskill, very respected, well-regarded engineering firm, 52 employees. They did an independent engineering report. Obviously, the structural damage was at the forefront. Turns out there was $96,000 worth of structural damage to the house. So we submitted that to Allstate. That still wasn't enough. What they wanted was the engineer's notes, his scratch notes, where he came up with his figures, and that was the final straw for me, to make a long story short. That was the final straw. I said, no. Let's go to court. You submit your engineering report to a judge, and I'll submit mine, and, you know, we'll see who gets laughed at, because it's, you know, it's clear that the structural damage is still evident. I mean, we haven't removed it. The rubble is still there. The depreciation on contents was also a brutal process. I already mentioned the hearing aid and the carpeting, but another thing that came to mind is I had my career is in finance, and I had a lot of reference books, finance and economic and investing reference books, and they cost, you know, anywhere from $30 to $100 a piece, and I had a collection, I had a library, if you will, small library of these reference manuals, and they were all destroyed in the flooding, and I put a very conservative estimate in the claim of $1,500. They were worth a lot more than that. But, you know, I put in $1,500, and yet Allstate still depreciated them by 99%. They offered us 1% of the value, or $15 total on the books. So I guess, you know, what I would recommend, if possible, is I've been thinking about how flood insurance compares to, for example, life insurance. And I know there's many experts at the table that will maybe be able to figure out a way to do this, or maybe not, I don't know. But if you have life insurance, your premium is based upon the actuarial risks that the insurance company sees in you. Are you a smoker? Are you overweight? So on. And whatever the risk factor is, that is the the premium that you will pay, and if, heaven forbid, somebody dies, that's the amount, the full amount that that family expects to receive. The insurance company doesn't come back to you and say, well, I know your husband had a $100,000 insurance policy, but after all, it turns out he smoked, he had high cholesterol, and I don't know, that looks like his life expectancy was probably only another 10 years anyway, so we'll offer you $10,000. I mean, that doesn't happen. You get a check. The widow gets a check for $100,000. There should be some way that flood insurance is done the same way. Flood insurance premiums are also based upon risk. My premium was relatively low because I was not in a flood zone. It was low risk of a flood. People in a flood zone pay a higher premium. So it seems to me that there should be some figure, some number. If you have a flood insurance policy and you've paid your premium and you have more than, I don't know, I'll use a figure of 12 inches of water in your first floor, that means all of your electrical, all of your plumbing, all of your walls, all of your floors, everything is gone and needs to be replaced. If you have over a certain level of water in your house and you have flood insurance, I think you should get the full amount of the premium, or the full amount, I'm sorry, of the policy coverage. It shouldn't be that, okay, well, you've passed hurdle one in that you have the insurance, but now you have to prove to us what your contents were, what the values were, when did you buy them, how old is that sofa, did you have any damage? It just seems to me if you have insurance, as Congressman Tonko well said, you expect them to pay.
Well, thank you.
Yes,
thank you, Bill, for sharing your story. And I, you covered a lot of territory there. And, but does anyone have any thoughts or comments regarding what we've heard?
Senator Seward, Mark Reigel from New York Central Mutual. I'm an AVP of underwriting as well as a flood administrator. We're a write-your-own carrier. We've entered into an arrangement with NFS Stone River. They handle our claims and our policy administration. After experiencing the 2006 flood and knowing some of the hurdles there, we were prepared that if another event like that happened, that we knew exactly what we needed to do. So after watching the news and seeing the devastation that was hitting in Delaware County and Schoharie County, that Monday morning I got on the phone with NFS and said, look, this is a devastating flood that just occurred, and we need your help. We need to make sure you respond to our insureds. New York Central sets very high standards for their claims practices. We expect the same thing. NFS listened to us. They were prepared to answer the bell. And all along the way, we communicated. They helped us out when there was problems. Secondly, I reached out to our agency plant saying, if there was a problem, please get to us. Let us know if there's anything going on wrong, that we want to get involved before it needs to be elevated to the next level. We had great success in doing that. You know, there was an instance over Columbus Day weekend where an insured, you know, was starting to get cold. They needed a furnace. There was a problem with a lost payee on a check. They called Friday at 5 o'clock and said, Mark, this guy needs to get his furnace in. What can you do? I called NFS. We worked with the agent. We were able to get a furnace, a check sent to the insured overnighted. On Tuesday morning, they had that check. So there is, if there's communication, working with your carriers, there is good stories. It's not all bad stories. So we're very happy with how our vendor provided service to its insurers.
Senator, the story from the good homeowner in Schoharie County is not unique to Schoharie County. As a 37-year insurance professional, I'm embarrassed to tell you it happened too many times during the storm. And one of the biggest problems is the differences in coverages. The flood insurance policy is an ACV policy, actual cash value. The homeowner's policy is a replacement cost policy. Therein lies one of the biggest dilemmas. When multiple adjusters are assigned to adjust the loss, they have different interests. Not always the premium paying insured's interest. We found a provision in the Write Your Own Subsidy Agreement, Section 3, Article 2, that states a single adjuster must be assigned for both wind and flood. The company shall agree to adjust of combined claim utilizing one adjuster. That's something that I would hope the insurance department would put out a circular letter, research. We gave your staff all the details. We backed up with some written testimony. I think that would go a long way. Insurance claims are very complex today, and delays associated with multiple adjusters. And also we found there were adjusters brought in that weren't trained with the NFIP adjustment standards. And this is the first major type loss or catastrophe we had. There may be a new generation of adjusters. I applaud New York Central for them, their vigilance on behalf of their policyholders. But it isn't unique, that story, to Allstate. There's a lot of carriers that didn't put the same premium on their insurance that New York Central did.
I don't want to sound like a cynic. I've been in the litigation business for most of my young life. And what I find is that when there is a claim, whether it's a property damage claim, whether it's a personal injury claim, there is a strategy with the insurance industry to hold on to the funds as long as they can. And they invest them. And they delay, and they delay, and they delay. And the thinking is, if we can hold on to the funds and put that victim off for 2 to 4 years, we will cover that loss with the earnings that we will make from our investments. Now, many of the insurance companies are publicly traded. They have obligations to their stockholders. And we can talk as much as we want about who are the good guys that stepped up, who are maybe the bad guys, and we had one insurance company mentioned today. But how do we get over the generic problem of how profits and losses are made? And how do we standardize that to deliver justice to the victim? So that's something that we can take many steps to try to make things better. But we're still up against the investment strategy and the public policies of insurance companies that trade on the open markets. So I just make that point. Thank
Senator,
you,
Senator. And if I could just address that briefly, because I think that goes to the nature of the flood insurance program. And we do operate through private write-your-own companies who receive an expense allowance for their expenses incurred in running the program. They also receive additional amount for the adjustment of a claim. But the payment of claims, it comes from the federal treasury. And there's not, and they can't draw that funding until the check is paid to the homeowner. So at least with regard to the federal program, that motivation really should not be in play. I'm not sure how it could be in play, because there are federal mechanisms, there's oversight, there's inspector generals who look at that sort of thing. So I can't speak to the insurance industry in general, but as far as the flood insurance program, there's not that motivation just to hold on to the money.
My remarks were addressed to the insurance industry, not to FEMA.
Oh, okay, thank you.
Senator, if I could, I'd like to respond to your comments. I've been with Allstate for 34 years, and frankly, I'm taken aback by your comments. There is no such strategy that you suggest. I've been in the claim department for 34 years. The claim department, there is no such strategy whatsoever to hold on to funds. It's been my experience. I've been directed, and I have directed others, to pay claims as fairly and as quickly as possible. Issues, complexities do occur. I grant you that. But it is not a strategy to hold on to funds at all.
If I may, a couple of things have been mentioned, and I think, in fact, as Mr. Fried talks about with the flood insurance program, there's actually an incentive to get the claims paid quickly. They want to do that because the insurance company actually gets a percentage of the claim. So if they pay more, they even get a little bit more for settling the claim. They want to do so in a fine and a fair manner There's a couple things that I think were mentioned that there are some major differences between a homeowner's policy and a flood insurance policy. Flood insurance has not been, it's a very good program, but it was designed as really a catastrophic policy. It was not designed to be a competitive market policy like the homeowner's product is. And, you know, originally it did even cover damage in basements. Now it only covers the HVAC equipment necessary to do the home, to take care of the home in the basement. It only covers replacement cost on the structure, not on the contents. That is a difference between a homeowner's policy. There are two deductibles, one for the contents, one for the building. On a flood policy and not on a homeowner's policy. I applaud Mr. Cherry for buying the policy because I think that was a smart move. One of the things I think he talked about was the fact that the flood waters came around the dam. One of the things I think we're concerned with the whole program countrywide, and certainly was evidenced here, it has been evidenced in following Katrina, is nature will find a way. Whether you're behind a dam or a levee or whatever you're behind, and if you think you're not in a flood zone, let me tell you, nature's going to find a way for that water to get there. I would point out that one of the things I think the flood program did in 2004 when federal legislation was passed was they provided, and it was sent to every policyholder that there is, and it's given out at every claims, it's a claims handbook produced by FEMA, and our industry worked with FEMA to generate that. There's a step-by-step process in here that tells you everything you need to do to help get your claim settled, including the ability, as Mr. Cherry pointed out, to write to FEMA and get a response. I can tell you also that after having, from what I can understand, 17,000 claims, 17,800, almost 18,000 claims on flood, and over $464 million dollars paid out of the flood program for these two events in New York alone, that you're not going to get it right every time. But as I look at the list of the number of claims that have been paid and the number of claims that are still out there, we're talking about 3% that are still not settled. That's not, by most standards, a huge amount. Now, there are people that have had issues, and I believe that that's something that needs to be addressed. We certainly want to work with FEMA, with the New York Department, with you folks to do whatever we can to straighten out those issues. And I applaud the Senator for having this meeting during National Flood Awareness Week as something that we need to do. But I think that's one of the key things that we're missing here is that fortunately, and unfortunately for Mr. Cherry, fortunately he bought the flood insurance or he would have nothing right now. And second of all, we need to work with the buying public so that they understand there's a significant difference between what the product is and that we as an industry, the insurance industry, are merely the administrators for FEMA. If we want to make changes to the flood program, it's up for debate right now in Congress. We need a long-term reauthorization of this program. One thing I would encourage you folks to do, if anything, is to get your New York delegation, including you, Representative Tonko, behind the fact that there needs to be a long-term reauthorization of this program passed. It's in limbo right now. It's going to expire again on May 31st of this year, the day before hurricane season. And that's something we don't want to see happen. Our industry is a faithful administrator of this program in partnership with the federal government. But only Congress has the ability to change how the program works, and that's something to keep in mind as we go through these discussions.
Let me just touch on for just one quick moment. I heard a lot of righteous indignation, and I understand where the righteous indignation comes from. I do, but I think there are threads through the stories that we heard today when it comes to multiple adjusters that are troubling, and I think it also is incumbent upon the industry to recognize that there are troubling aspects to the stories that we've heard here today that go beyond just saying that this is a national policy and it'll be addressed by Congress. There is a responsibility also to go back and look at how some of these things actually occur. I wanted to reiterate a point that Mr. Greenfield made and on the differences between a cash value policy as opposed to a replacement value policy. And it was something I wasn't aware of, but certainly having survived or having dealt with an episode after a fire and dealt with insurance companies, I have a certain mindset when it comes to disaster relief. And as I was hearing Mr. Cherry's deciding his travails after the storm, I said, well, what's the difference between flood insurance and fire insurance? Because if you're going to value the contents, and I remember what we went through in order to do that, and it was a process that was difficult, but it was fairly straightforward. That explains it. And certainly if there's a component to this that we, I think, should stress, it's the educational component, that people may not necessarily have the right expectation when it comes to flood insurance.
If I may also add, though, in my opinion, again, as a public adjuster, just representing insureds, to me it's more than just the difference in the contract. It's the difference in the attitude. I find it's hard enough for people to handle their own houses when it burns or businesses when it burns. But when you're dealing with national flood and the contract, it just seems to me that the insurance company adjusters are acting robotically, that they have to obtain information. If it's not exactly what they need at the home office level, then it is rejected. We're handling a loss now where it's a large building. It's insured for $4 million with the excess carrier. National flood just has $500,000 on it. They're requiring three contractors' estimates. The loss is well in excess of its policy limit. Matter of fact, the second carrier has already advanced over $1 million, but we're not able to get the $500,000 from National Flood because there's more information that they need. And it seems to me that their adjusters are trying to handle these things by autopilot, if you will. If they aren't able to obtain the correct information, the loss is rejected. We're handling a loss now for an auto parts store in Yonkers, New York, where we were told it had no salvage, that the owner had the right to have all of the salvage disposed of. He brought in dumpsters, had everything gone. When it went to the regional office or whoever they happened to report to, it's hard for us as public adjusters and for the insureds to find out who the supervisors are, to be able to call to talk to these people. But in this particular case, somebody just automatically thought there was $16,000 worth of salvage in these auto parts that the insurance company said had no value. They sent a salvo out who they indicated didn't have any value. But yet when they went to pay the claim, they arbitrarily subtracted $16,000 off of the insurance check and told the insured if they didn't like it, they'd have to appeal. But there was no discussion, there was no dialogue in regards to that. I don't understand why the insurance policy requires proofs to be filed within 60 days. In New York State, the law is that you only have to file a proof of loss if it is requested by the insurance company and they furnish you with a blank proof. There is no relief under National Flood. The insured has 60 days to file a proof. Now, with Hurricane Lee and Hurricane Irene, it was good that they extended those for certain periods, one of which they extended 4 days before the proofs of loss were due. I had my office working 24 hours to get proofs of loss out. I had homeowners crying on the other end of the phone about getting these proofs in time to find out that the period was going to be extended. And then when you do have an issue with the proof of loss, so I don't know why the owner has to file a proof of loss unless it's requested, why you have a blanket demand for a proof, I don't understand. And the last point I just wanted to raise right now, as it says here, this is in the insurance company policy. At our option, we may accept the adjuster's report, meaning their adjuster's report, instead of your proof of loss. The adjuster will include information about your loss and the damages you sustained. You must sign the adjuster's report. At our option, we may require you to swear it. So the way I understand this, and I've spoken to quite a few lawyers in regards to this, if a homeowner believes they have a $100,000 loss, but the insurance company believes it's only $50,000, the homeowner has to sign a sworn proof of loss that says their loss is $50,000 before they'll advance any monies or issue the check for the $50,000. So now when you go to appeal and you have the proof that's signed that says your loss is $50,000, and now you're saying it's $100,000, how does the homeowner going to be able to defend that? And my opinion, doesn't make any sense. I've instructed our people to put an asterisk next to the $50,000, make a simple asterisk, and just say the homeowner does not agree with the insurance company's figures. We are told, and I have emails here today, we are told that we can't argue that the homeowner can't alter a federal document and has to sign that proof of loss saying their loss is $50,000, although they know it's $100,000 or they won't get any money.
This is outrageous. And also, I just wanted to add regarding the comment about Allstate and how they happen to act in holding back the money, because I agree with the senator. I invite the people from Allstate to perhaps read the book From the Good Hands People to Boxing Gloves in the McKinsey Report, because it will explain since 1992 how Allstate has and other insurance carriers followed in regards to trying to deny claims and hold the insured down in regards to payment, and how someone can say that he's lucky that he was able to buy insurance when an individual buys insurance policy in good faith and writes a check. He's also buying a promise that the insurance company is going to stand by him when the loss occurs. And unfortunately for most of my clients and most of the people that I hear, they don't receive that promise. Thank you.
Senator, if I could just add to the comments made, there are many constituents who brought to our attention that same argument that Mr. Papa just made, and they even characterized it as bullying, which I find regrettable, that someone in a distressed situation would have to be impacted in that manner. And we also have not talked, and unfortunately I have to leave, but Sean Chertel will stay for my crew. I also heard too many times over about premium increases effective the date of the disaster. Effective the day of the disaster. Now, if we're at this table to really respond to people in need and provide an insurance company and allow an industry to exist and make profits, sometimes in record proportion, if we're in this effort to really affect constituents and consumers, let's do it in a way that shows a little respect for people who have been asked to endure a whole lot.
You know, we have had a lot of discussion about the multiple adjusters, and so I'd like to ask the FEMA folks to maybe talk about that, these adjusters. And I mean, are these adjusters that are sent out deal with the National Flood Insurance Program aspect of the loss? Are they selected by the write your own carriers, or are they certified? Are there any kind of standards by FEMA when it comes to the adjuster process?
The adjusters are assigned by the
write your own. If you could get into the
The adjusters are assigned by the write your own companies.
Senator, I may be able to shut
down. I'll let her answer that if you'd like to add it.
It's on. The adjusters are assigned by the Write Your Own companies, and they should be flood certified, which means that they've submitted a resume of their background, and then they've also attended the flood certification classes.
Let me ask you this, if I can jump in.
Sure.
Really talking about two different things, at least two different things. Yeah. One is, what's the nature of the coverage substantively?
Mm-hmm.
Two is, the process behind, I mean, you hear the story, the process behind getting that coverage, whatever it may be. And to me, if you focus on the latter, I think there are a lot of improvements we could probably make there. And I guess I open it up for discussion, but if the department issued a regulation saying every time there's a claim, we're going to require a single point of contact and a single adjuster, would anyone have a problem with that, oppose it? I mean, that sounds like that could, I mean, just imagine a situation, Mr. Cherry, where way back when, your first phone call is you get assigned a single point of contact. That's the only person you will deal with. They have your file every time you call. That's who you deal with. They know your case over time. And two, there's a single adjuster you're dealing with. Maybe he comes back four or five times because it's a complex case. But at least that's your guy. And, you know, the more we talk about it, I wonder whether that's a potential solution here that maybe even the industry wouldn't mind having to simplify things for you, especially, sounds like, if you pay the claim quicker, you make more money. So
If I could just address the adjuster from the federal perspective, and then I'll pass it over. But what FEMA does work through the companies, and FEMA doesn't direct the company to send out a particular adjuster or to how they're going to run their business locally. We do, as Karen alluded to, we do have training requirements and certification requirements that I believe are required for independent adjusters, and it may be a slightly different perspective for in-house adjusters. And so I think that may account for some of the claims that adjusters may not be certified. And for companies, they may need to be working under a certified person. But our program does have certification requirements. And we have regular training. I think we have thousands of training programs. When there's a disaster like this, we typically get out and we try to push the training to make sure that people are lined up, because I think historically there are problems with adjusters in some locations. if you haven't had significant flooding in upstate New York in 5 years, there's not a cadre of adjusters the way there would be for our car insurance and
we
things.
We have 15,000, I think, adjusters in the state approximately. Right after the storm, we allowed another, I think, 9,200 to come in from out of state just to boost that number from 15,000 to almost 25,000 to do exactly what you're saying.
But those aren't right. But they're not flood certified adjusters.
That's the challenge.
That's a problem that we
had.
That
is a problem.
It is.
Flood certification, I think there was, in the past year, there's only been maybe one class in Long Island. We've got an adjusting company in Buffalo. The expense that you have to incur to go down there, it was exorbitant. It wasn't something we could do. We've tried, I've contacted our U.S. senators in the past about trying to get some training somewhere in upstate, and the closest senators was Pittsburgh. So we struggle there.
I'd like to comment a little bit, too, about the claims process, too. Fidelity being the largest runner of flood insurance in the country, and that is the only thing we do, right? I'd like to make that clear. I can only speak for Fidelity. Again, we only write flood insurance. We have, and we only utilize a limited number of adjusting firms. And the reason for that, we do have the luxury because we are so large, we can feed adjusting firms claims on a regular basis. And that has been a challenge. After 2008, we really haven't seen a lot of claims come through the system. Well, the adjusters are no longer in the field. They're not working these claims. The single adjuster program in some areas has worked well. In other areas, it has not worked well. And the reason being flood certified. The coverages are so different from a homeowner's policy or a traditional property policy to a flood policy. But again, you know, with us controlling the number of adjusters we use and the number of firms we use, we put our thumb on those guys. We make them, problems occur, of course. Problems are going to occur. You're going to have that problematic claim. But at the end of the day, we have strict guidelines as to when our insurer is to be contacted. Because we only write flood insurance, I would be a little concerned if I had a homeowner's policy, they were dictating who the adjuster was going to be. You know, our adjusters get in there and they get out. Again, do we make a mistake occasionally? Of course we do. We're only human. But at the end of the day, our goal is to close that claim as rapidly and as fairly as possible.
Mr. Superintendent, I think we would welcome as agents a single adjuster, a single point of contact. And we would hope the industry would welcome it as controlling cost factors. However, that single adjuster must be flood certified. And the CAT adjusters that came in from out of town, they were in many cases better because they were trained and certified and experienced in settling CAT losses. There's been a lot of CATs in the South, in the Southwest, and they had a lot of experience. The problem is, in the rules and regulations, it does not require staff adjusters to be NFIP certified. That manual that was referred to is very good. We've seen it. We applaud it. But many of the adjusters that adjusted losses never saw that manual. And therein lies the problem. So hopefully Mr. Schwartzman could put out a regulation with respect to that and the certification, and we could have some training.
For the training.
For the training, right. The training piece seems... I think that's easily resolved, and there should be training in New York.
And I'd like to clarify, jump on that a little bit more, too, and to elaborate on that. That comment is very true. We experienced, under previous ownership, we did write homeowners policies. But what we did, and I think it was successful for us during Katrina, Rita, and Wilma, which we handled 65,000 claims, yes, we had homeowners, but we had a whole different team over here that handled the homeowners in a separate location. And we did, I'm talking about in-house adjusters, not your adjusters that go out in the field. But our homeowners, the people that examine those files, in-house adjusters, sat over here, and never did those files cross. So that flood adjuster that was in-house was specialized, they knew what to look for, and they knew how to handle that flood claim versus this homeowners person over here that handled the homeowners.
One of the other issues that we see is the insurance adjuster is quick. They are in and out, and I think that's how they get compensated. But they often just won't return. We ask them to make a reinspection because they missed area of damage, or in your particular case, with the damage to the foundation. But they just are very quick to say that they want to close their file and they don't want to return, and if you have an issue, then file an appeal. And I think that might have, that may be an issue because of the way that they're compensated. The other observation was made that roughly just 3% of the losses are open. I heard a very similar stat with Hurricane Katrina. And upon investigation, we found out that those were the people that received advances, but those other 97% of the losses weren't settled. Maybe they received some advance money, but those losses were not settled. We happen to find that advances are very slow in coming. And on the news last night, it was very interesting. I was watching an ad for National Flood, and it had a homeowner there, and it said a few inches of water caused all this, and it had a house that was damaged with some water in it. But we handle many losses where you have 3 or 4 inches of water in a building, in a home, for a week or so before the water is able to recede. And because of the water in the building, it causes the paneling to warp, it causes the ceiling to become damaged. The insurance company adjusters are told by whoever they report to that that's not covered under the policy, that that's not considered direct damage by flood, and they're to exclude it. They're supposed to draw where the water line came from, and from that area down is all that they owe for. So once again, as I said earlier, I just believe that the adjusters do not receive the discretion that they need to act to be able to examine a claim and to adjust it, rather than act, as I said before, just robotically. And to me and to our staff, that's the biggest single problem that we see in handling claims.
I wanted to, if I could, speak to the multiple adjuster situation that's been brought up several times before. The genesis of that is the, I can only speak for Allstate, but I think this is an industry issue. As we had the events that occurred last year that came up the entire Eastern Seaboard, our company, for example, we ramp up significantly to meet that demand. And very, very rapidly, we ramp up with staff both in-house and externally. As the claims begin to settle and close, we rapidly, decrease that staff commensurate with the amount of pending that we have as a cost, to make sure that we don't have adjusters with 3 claims pending, so we consolidate that staff as we go on. And where we see, and I'll acknowledge that we do see this repetitive adjuster issue, and it is problematic. And we typically see it in complex claims that pend for a long time, not unlike Mr. Cherry's claim. So that is something that we're very aware of. We try different strategies to try to minimize that, try to minimize the impact of that, one being having a claim, for lack of a better term, claim coordinator that continues to be that point person that you pointed out. So if there is a change in the field adjuster, we could still manage that claim through that claim coordinator that would be that single point of contact. So there are opportunities, and we're certainly open to discussions about how we make that process better for the more complex type claims that we see. By and large, the majority of the claims settle relatively quickly, but it's the longer term, the claims that have issues, whether they be structural or some other issue, where we can do a better job there. So we're very open to that conversation.
Fine. Sure. If I may, Senator. So I apologize if I seemed righteously indignant. I didn't really mean to be that way. I've been on the agency side, and I've been on the company side, and I've been standing where many of you have stood, knee deep in water, trying to help a claimant settle a claim like Mr. Cherry has. And please, do not let my remarks in any way diminish the fact that he has a real problem. Mm-hmm. And we need, as an industry and as a state and as a country, to do a better job for him. We need to do that. That needs to happen. But a couple of things that I think the other statement was about the claims. These are actually closed claims. All but 3% are actually closed at this point. And I think that the single adjuster program is something that could be very helpful. Or a single point of contact might be a better way to reference it rather than a single adjuster. I do know that the National Association of Insurance Commissioners, and I'm trying to remember whether New York adopted it or not, when FEMA came out with some pretty new and strong training guidelines, most of the states went around and adopted those guidelines as to what needed to be trained. I'd have to check to make sure, Marty, maybe you know, but I don't remember whether New York adopted those or not. But certainly I think that's something that could be done better. I think that there can be better ways for people to settle these and get these done. I know one of the concerns I heard was with regard to cancellation. Our organization put out a regulator's hand kit, a disaster hand kit that has a few little sample regulations that could be used after an event like this that talks about not canceling the policy when people can't get their mail, for example, or can't, you know, aren't around to be, get the payment. You know, we're more than willing to share that with the department. We may have in the past. But I think there's some things that we can do, and some of those things would be helpful. But some of those things are also just for people to know the real difference between what the policy covers and what it doesn't, and that flood is an entirely different product than most people are concerned with. And I think one of the things that we seem to forget is while we are the insurance industry here representing the insurance industry, we are the administrators of the program. We're trying to help run the program because it is a federal program. If there were premium increases the day of the event, certainly that wasn't anything that we did as an industry. That was done because it was time for FEMA to make change, as they do annually, in their rates.
Another piece on the adjuster I think is very important is, and I've heard this from Peggy being up in Schoharie County a few times, is the information that the adjusters have been providing to homeowners is wrong. In other words, when an adjuster is coming out, they really should be trained to do the adjustment, not make final determinations or tell people what's covered and not covered just by walking in. And yeah, there's been a lot of bad information, and I think that has really complicated this process, is when they leave the homeowners with bad information, that's when a lot of times it starts, right up front.
I would reiterate what Marty said, because that's, we do have requirements, and what I heard here before about some of the requirements of proof of loss, yeah, sorry, that just wasn't accurate. So if that is the information that's getting out, then there's a gap there. I totally agree that that needs
that's to happening, and I think the insurers need to be more diligent about training and speaking with adjusters on what their responsibilities are. And if you had that single point of contact with the insurer, to make that final determination.
Marty, you're absolutely right. Then we get a phone call from the hysterical insured attacking us that they don't have coverage, but they didn't have coverage under the flood policy, but they have it under the homeowners. They don't understand, especially if they have both policies with the same carrier, they don't understand the right you're wrong. Is different rules and regulations, and this adjuster doesn't understand, and he's giving out information. That's why we need the single adjuster, the single point of contact.
Yeah, I would just ask on this point of the ask the FEMA people it strikes me that the people, of course, you know, they pay their premiums, and then when there is a loss, they're dealing with adjusters, multiple adjusters. I mean, I would think that you would have a great deal of interest in just how that process is playing out, because in fact, for many folks, that is their exposure to the National Flood Insurance Program, and particularly the very vulnerable time for them. Many have been left with a bad taste in their mouth because of that experience. I mean, I would think that would be a concern of yours in terms of looking for ways to improve from your end in terms of standards for the adjusters, keeping an eye on the right your own. I mean, they are your representatives out in the field.
Right, absolutely, and we do, as I said, we do have training programs. That is important to FEMA, and it's been something that we've implemented in the last 10 or 12 years or so, is a more rigorous formal training program. So we'll definitely take back and look at some of the issues that have arisen, whether it's with in-house adjusters or how we need to improve that process, definitely.
Now, if just Mr. Cherry said, in terms of an appeal process, he's unhappy. He apparently sent a letter in, which has not been responded to. Could you explain what is the appeal process?
Sure, absolutely. And please, before we leave, make sure you know, let's
somehow
talk
I think he will get
that.
An answer to his letter.
I don't know. Yeah, we'll find out where that is. But the because the appeals process is a large part of our ability to exercise oversight. We, the federal staff that's involved in this is not that large. It's one of the reasons why we run it through the private insurance industry. There are many reasons that there's marketing issues and the structure that's already built into an insurance company that allows them to better deliver some of the services. But We exercise oversight in large part through the appeal process, and we do have a staff of people who are available and respond to appeals, review claims files once a claim has been finalized to make sure that the money's getting put out properly. It's something that was implemented about, I say, it was since 2000, since the Hurricane Isabel, which also hit the East Coast and around Maryland and in that area, we recognized that there was really a need for that sort of oversight, and we do have that now. You have some questions about how that runs specifically, because basically we come in, we then coordinate with the insured and the insurance company. We try to just, we don't send out necessarily a readjustment. We do have the ability, if there's along in the process, to send out one of the staff adjusters we have with our contractor to review claims, and we'll do that as well if there's an issue on that part. But otherwise we would try to get there and have that as a step before the judicial process, whatever takes over.
We as companies also go through many, many audits from FEMA, whether it be our operational review, biennial audits, various audits. Due to the size of our company and the number of flood policies we have, there's some sort of audit going on every year. And ensuring that we're handling our claims appropriately, whether it be in time service, the amount paid, or just basically how the claim was handled.
Before we leave this topic, too, I just wanted to go back. I wasn't aware of Mr. Cherry's individual situation until this meeting. Actually, just prior to this meeting, we introduced each other to each other. I did acknowledge that I would go back and understand exactly, from a procedural standpoint, what happened in Mr. Cherry's claim so that we can learn from it. I know his claim has now been settled, but I want to make sure that operationally, whatever the issues were, are not repeated. So that is my commitment to Mr. Cherry as well as this committee.
Well, if I may, thank you. And that's really the reason I accepted the senator's invitation to be here today. Not on behalf of myself. I'm one of the lucky ones in this flood in that I still have my job my wife has her job. We had some savings. So, we had the financial wherewithal to go to a hotel and then rent an apartment, which is where we still are. So, I'm not here, I'm not here as a victim. It's an act of God, and we're all dealing with it. But there's a lot of folks who have suffered. My situation is inconvenient, but there's some folks who have really suffered that don't have the ability to relay their situation to ladies and gentlemen of your stature and your position. They're just all they know is their double wide or their small house is gone. I know one guy that ran a small auto repair business, lived in a double wide, the garage is gone. Obviously, it means his income is gone. He didn't own that. He rented this garage. His income went from whatever it was to zero overnight, and his home is gone. It's folks like that that are really suffering. So I'm not here. I'm okay, and my wife and I are going to be okay. But if you can all work together to find a way to help those folks that are still suffering, or heaven forbid the next time it happens, because it's a terrible spot to be in when all of your life's belongings are a muddy clump, a heap in the front yard. You don't know where to turn. Folks are going to turn to people like you, so if you can find a way to make it easier for them, that's the right way to do it.
We appreciate you looking into that situation.
One of the things I wanted to address, if I could quickly, is the issue of the appeal, because I have here the flood insurance claims handbook. There are approximately 46 items that they want the insured to make available for the appeal, one of which is their tax returns, death certificates, power of attorney, all sorts of estimates, financial statements, et cetera. And of the few times I've heard of policyholders invoking appeal, it seems to take about a year, keeping in mind that the statute or the time to bring suit under the policy is a year from denial. And it says that if you bring suit under the policy, then the appeal process is automatically stopped. And of the few people that I know that have gone to appeal, it seems to them that it's more or less a rubber stamp of the insurance company's report. The other thing, though, I also wanted to comment on is Superintendent Alosky's comment in regards to more people needing flood insurance, because you're exactly right in that regard. And we spoke to quite a few homeowners in Broome County, in Chenango County, and other areas that were devastated. And they were all, a lot of them were told the same thing pretty much, that their insurance agent told them they didn't need it. And I think more education as to, and I think that I'm in an area in Buffalo, New York, where we haven't had any issues with flood. But with the changes in the weather pattern and that, I think maybe it's a wise investment to have. And you're right, if there's a way to spread the risk so that more people can have it and a little better understanding of it, I think that's going to serve everybody.
Let me give you an example. About 3 or 4 years ago, and I don't know if it's still the case now, my understanding is in order to qualify for flood insurance, you had to be designated to be either in a floodplain or in a flood area. I was the mayor of a village on Long Island that was about 120 or 130 feet above sea level. But with all of the storms that we did have, we had a number of homeowners who had sustained flood damage over a period of time, and multiple times because we had those storms sequentially. We actually had to, as a municipality, designate ourselves to be in a flood zone so that our homeowners and businesses would be able to purchase flood insurance. And if we begin to deal with the issue of qualifications and predicates for flood insurance and why so few people sometimes have it, one of the things I think, one of the lessons from the events of this past year is no one's immune. You don't know when you're going to need flood insurance, not only from an educational standpoint, but also let's educate our municipalities, because oftentimes somebody may seek out flood insurance but be told that they're not in an area that allows them to get it. So maybe we should talk about that as well.
Senator, I'd
like to address the misconception about the appeals process. The appeals process is a 90-day process. It doesn't take a year. And the list of items in there are a list that can be requested or the insured can submit to you know, for their appeal to prove their points. Not a list of required items. It's a list of items that can be submitted.
Well, it indicates here the following are examples of the kinds of documents that FEMA will require. Why would they require, let me just ask you this one rhetorical question. Why would they require a market value appraisal when the insurance policy says that actual cash value is replacement cost plus depreciation?
Those are lists of just whatever could possibly be required. If you have a specific example, we'd be more than happy to address it.
That's the example I'm using then.
No, it's specific. Value. A specific one. There could be any reason whatsoever that it could be. But this list is not something that's required on every file all the time. It's just a list. These documents that can be requested.
Okay. As a representative of homeowners, if a person sees this online like I did, they're going to be intimidated as to we have to gather all of this information. And again, I'll just use as my example.
We've had many appeals, and no one has had problems with that.
Well, how many appeals haven't you had because individuals look at this and say this is too onerous of a task, and they walk away?
I couldn't tell you.
Exactly.
That's our experience.
I couldn't tell you, but we've had many, many appeals where people submitted it without any documentation whatsoever. So they're not being intimidated by the list.
But you don't know if the people who are, because the people that look at this and just shut down the computer and say, never mind, it isn't worth the fight. I mean, if you didn't have the wherewithal to do what you did, how many homeowners would just walk away? That's my point. That's my observation.
I'd like to just mention there are, like, as with any insurance product, but the National Flood Insurance Program is governed by Congress. It's a federal program. Did there changes need to be made? Oh, sure. I mean, I can see that there, and FEMA is working very close with Congress. We're working with FEMA to make sure some of these changes occur to make it easier. But the flood policy is a very different policy from, as we've heard, the homeowner's policy. education. There needs to be more education out there. I've been working with the flood program since 1993, and I'm lovingly called the flood diva because anytime I get a chance to speak to people about flood insurance, I do. If I'm seeing in line at the grocery store, everyone needs flood insurance. It's not a matter of no risk. There's always some risk. And if you're a low to moderate risk, your premiums are very low. But again, we could get better coverage across, but we can't really do a whole lot with this program until we get a long-term reauthorization. We've been going month to month, sometimes week to week. We can't make these changes. We can't work with FEMA. FEMA can't work with Congress. The companies can't work with Congress to get this done. So the first and the foremost thing is to get this long-term reauthorization so that we can make some of these changes, these important changes. You have to get very passionate about it.
Let me ask, as the month-to-month, the short-term nature of the National Flood Insurance Program, has that, at the state level with the, we look at the solvency of the carriers. Now, does that, in terms of being the ability to pay claims, now how does that relate to this question in terms of the flood insurance?
Sure, but I'll discuss. There are a couple issues, actually, I'd like to address quickly. But in terms of the authorization, we have a five-year authorizing statute, and it's been since 1968. It's periodically been reauthorized, and you know, it's up to Congress to do that. What expires if the authorization expires is FEMA's ability to sell new policies. So policies that are in effect will continue to be serviced. They're for a year term. And the Flood Insurance Fund, which is the pot of federal money which is maintaining the federal treasury to pay the claims and everything that goes along with the program, is in existence. We have obligations, and we're backed by the federal treasury. There's limits to that, but we that's where. So claims get paid whether or not the program is authorized. What's going to happen is there's a limitation on ability to sell new policies, limitations when there's mandatory purchase for somebody if somebody wants to get a loan or so forth, to then be able to finance that with a loan. There's huge consequences to it, but it's not going to the ability to pay claims. Well, it has nothing to do with the solvency of companies. It's our solvency, and so far we're still solvent.
Senator, the problem comes up when a homeowner is buying a new home in a flood zone, and the bank and the lender requires flood insurance, and we've had too many lapses. And I'll be in Washington in 10 days to lobby for, like I've been lobbying for the last 3 years, for a five-year reauthorization, a long-term solution, and also amendments and changes to the program. One of the amendments is pending, and I want the superintendent to know this. The flood maps that were redone in Southwest Nassau are wrong. It's widely acknowledged they're wrong. And people are being put in flood zones that were never in flood zones. And instead of Zone X, and the premium was minimum premium, $350, they now go up to $2,400 to $2,800 because people by the Southern State Parkway are now in a flood zone where before it was closer to the water. So they, I know Senator's been to the Southern State.
Yeah.
Skelos' district, I know.
Yeah.
But as a result of that, we have this amendment pending to redraw the maps. There's also a two-year grandfathering provision that's going to expire soon. So if the maps aren't corrected, people that are grandfathered are suddenly, in these bad economic times and times of high taxes on Long Island, are going to see their grandfathered $340 premium on renewal go to $2,400 to $2,800. So time is of the essence, and Congress has only been doing short-term reauthorizations and haven't done this amendment. I would welcome the superintendent to join me in the lobbying effort or someone from the department when we go down there for our national lobbying day on this issue. And the education piece, Senator, is your law in the Chapter 21 of the laws of 2008. There's an annual requirement that every homeowner's policy must have a plug or an advertisement or tell you that there's a necessity for flood insurance. I would love the department to review that and rewrite it because it doesn't explain the actual cash value versus replacement cost. I think that has to be explained. And we have to do more in education. You could use flood insurance even if you haven't had a flood, changing conditions. Myself,
I sent a mailing designed by my association to every one of my homeowners insured at the start of hurricane season last year. And I wrote some policies. I more than paid for the effort. But I wanted to cover myself. I want to make sure my customers are taken care of. And I wanted to close the door on any errors and omissions possibility where people said, you didn't tell me I needed flood insurance after the fact. And I thought I did the right thing, and I encourage many of my fellow agents to do the same thing. And we can't do enough to educate people, and we need some leadership from the Senate and leadership from the department on that issue of education.
I'll just add, I think it's Reg 18, is that right? That has the reg for the disclosures that go along with the homeowner's policy.
Yes.
About flood insurance. We're looking at that very closely. I think it can be more robust.
Circular letter.
It's a circular letter 18. Circular letter 18. We're going to take a very close look at that. I do feel like this is on us a little bit now, especially me personally, since I saw what happened and I stood there with Senator Seward and heard from person after person after person say, I was told I didn't need flood insurance. I'm not in a floodplain. And that misunderstanding that doesn't matter whether you're in a floodplain or not, you can get flood insurance in this state. And if you live in Middleburg and you don't have flood insurance, that's a problem, because go look up the street at that river running down there. And that's on me a little bit now, and I will do what I have to do to sort of put the word out, both through the circular letter, but I think there are other smart strategies we can engage in to really let people know. You have to think very seriously. I don't care where you live. I'm in a third-floor apartment in New York City, and I'm thinking about it.
But I'll give you my card in. Senator, but we would welcome, as Professional Insurance Agents Association, to work with the department. We have some ideas on stuff that we've put out to our members, and we would welcome if you would embrace it.
Senator, yeah. Senator Martins, you mentioned briefly that your community was not, you couldn't get flood. Okay. It wasn't because necessarily you weren't in a flood zone. You, as I understand it, and Jordan, you can help me with this. You have to participate in the community rating system. When Congress passed this law, they had a couple goals, three goals, as I recall, in 1968. The first one was to stop the flow out of money post-disaster by actually taking some money in to help pay for these events. The second one was to, provide some protection for people that couldn't find it in the private marketplace. And the third one was really to help communities build more damage-resistant areas. And so they set up a community rating system. And then once you, as a community, participate in the community rating system, it means you will install certain building requirements. And so just because you're not in a flood zone doesn't mean you can't buy flood insurance. As the superintendent mentioned, you can buy it even if you're on the third floor apartment or if you're on the 50th floor if you want to, if your community participates.
If your community participates. If your community does not participate, then you're left without an option.
Right. And I would love to address that because we can agree on this. People should buy more flood insurance, and FEMA encourages that. So when I hear that there's agents who tell people that you don't need it because you're not in a flood zone, I don't know the numbers exactly, but something like 30 or 40% of all flood claims actually are from outside a flood zone. You're eligible for a significantly decreased premium. There's a special policy if you're not in a special flood hazard area, so you can get cheap flood insurance. And there's a lot of people who are aware that there's a risk in their community and they can take advantage of this. And they don't. And it's the same with communities, actually. If FEMA has a large component of the flood insurance program is also identifying the flood hazard. So we go out and we map and we use scientific standards and they're not perfect, but it's the best, according to the best, then we change it all the time. But if your community is mapped into a special flood hazard area, then there's an onus on the community to go ahead and start participating. And if you don't, then there's limitations on the disaster assistance you can get and that sort of thing. If you're not mapped in a special flood hazard area, actually it's very easy to participate. There's requirement on the community to implement these minimum flood standards. If you aren't in a special flood hazard area, that's not there. I know. It is in some ways incumbent upon the local community to recognize that this is a need.
They are minimum standards, and they are not onerous. They're not difficult. They don't, in many instances, they don't actually add anything other than what the community is already doing. My point is, I think we have an opportunity to reach out to those communities that haven't participated because Absolutely. Those individuals who live in those communities don't even have the option.
Mm-hmm. Right, absolutely.
I think I heard a commercial there somewhere where you said 30 or 40% of people who avail themselves of flood insurance aren't in floodplains. Well, people don't know that. And so to the extent that people right. don't, maybe we need to do a better job in getting that message out as well.
Yeah, that's 100% right. And if the bank or the mortgagee didn't require it, I mean, the only time when we saw many people with flood insurance in Binghamton, which was to us an anomaly because most places that we've gone to for flood, they're just not insured. But quite a few had it in those areas because the banks required it, and thank God for that.
Senator Morton, you're right. I appeared at the Nassau County Village Official Association on behalf of the industry to try to explain to some of the mayors what the prior speaker said. You had to be part of the community rating program under the federal law. My own village, where my office is in Lynbrook, didn't understand that. I got them to embrace it. People were impacted, and they needed that to qualify for Zone X to get the lower premiums. I know your village didn't realize it, adopted it. Maybe the department can assist in education through the villages, and I think also the Secretary of State also has contact with the villages and explain to them a lot of, after those crazy, freaky March storms of a couple, 3 years ago, a lot of the villages on Long Island, especially on the South Shore, Southwest Nassau, woke up to this and embraced it.
We had 300-500-year storms in, I think, right. a little over 6 months.
You know, one other area that is great for the communities to know, too, there are approximately 22,000 participating communities in the National Flood Insurance Program. And while it requires very minimal requirements, like you said, most communities are doing them already for no additional cost, but the more safety that the community can bring to the general public, they get credits for that. And in turn, for their flood insurance policy, they can get discounts on their flood insurance policy for having higher safety abilities.
I think that the best way to sell more flood insurance is to have people having good claims experiences. In Schoharie County, I mean, there's some people who were satisfied with their flood insurance, but I don't hear those stories. What I hear is, as the senator has mentioned, is, you know, a general overall unhappiness with the flood insurance program. So if I had a great experience, not great experience, you're flooded and it's still going to be traumatic and a problem, but if my experience in filing a claim and getting paid from the flood insurance people was different, and I could say to my neighbors, listen, I know you weren't in the floodplain either, but I had flood insurance and I'm going to be okay and I'm going to be able to go back and rebuild my house, and you need to get flood insurance, I think you'd sell a lot more flood insurance. But right now, I don't know how it is on a national level, but I can tell you in Schoharie County, the general overall attitude is who needs flood insurance, because even when you have it, you're not going to get paid. So
I'd like to address a little bit of that, too. And I think, and I'm just, again, we did not have that many claims in the New York area. But I know when we look at other areas that have experienced a large number of claims, the insureds, the agents, the adjusters in the area, they all become very knowledgeable of the policy. They know the differences. They know that there's two deductibles. They know there's very limited, if any, coverage for the basements. They know its actual cash value on your contents. Again, nuances that are to the flood program that are not to your traditional property policy. When we have events that are areas that do not have events on a regular basis, it's the education. We have got to get this education out to the public that what the policy does cover and what it doesn't.
It's more than that, though. I'm sorry. My local agent was CEFQ. It's a big company in New York. And they bent over backwards for me. They did everything they can. They sent emails to Allstate saying that they had never seen such a dysfunctional process in their entire lives and that they were embarrassed that I was their client and that they were going through this. So, you know, it wasn't just me as a homeowner and, gee, I think I'm covered, and it turns out I'm not. I mean, there were insurance professionals fighting on my behalf, and even they could not get through this mire of a process. And they knew exactly what I was covered for, even if I maybe didn't. So, you know, it's more than just people homeowners not understanding what's covered. It is a claims process that makes it as difficult, it feels as difficult as possible.
Interesting. I had the same experience when I talked to people, and it comes back to this. There's the substantive what is covered, and there's the process behind it. I found, for example, when we were in Rockland County, there was a whole neighborhood at one point where everyone's basement got ruined. The water rose just high enough. There was another dam situation, and it was just high enough that everyone's basement was ruined, but the houses otherwise were okay. Once people got answers, you know, flood insurance, you have it, you don't have it, and by the way, it doesn't cover basements, you know, cover your boiler, cover your washer dryer, and that's it, but not the basement. People were fine with that.
Absolutely.
They just wanted answers. Small businesses, and Schoharie and Middleburg, same thing. They need to plan their businesses and how they're going to get back on their feet. They just needed an answer. You're going to get coverage for this amount, and then they'll plan around it. Maybe they'll shut their business down, maybe they won't, but at least they know what the situation is. And it was this uncertainty. And that really affected, I think, individuals psychically especially, but also businesses in their planning. And that's what we really got to change.
Okay. Let me just jump in, if I may. We talk about the consumer having knowledge of coverage, if he has coverage. Again, I'm going to share with you common experiences. I look at my homeowner's policy every year. I look at my commercial policy every year. And I can tell you that I can't understand the language that is spoken in those policies. Now, I think I'm pretty sophisticated. What does a lame person do that pays? I get 35 pages of a commercial policy, and I see the word exceptions. Whatever they say in the front, it's Chinese for the rest of the writing. So it would be my suggestion, whether it's flood insurance, whether it's homeowners policies, we have to have a page in plain language. This is covered, this is not covered. That's not happening today. Now, I know this was a takeoff today on flood insurance. That's what got us here in the insurance industry. But the problem is bigger. The problem is bigger in transparency, plain language. The consumer doesn't know half the time. Most of the time, they just say, I paid a premium, I'm covered for whatever happens. So you could talk about all the education you want for the consumer, but if it's not in the policy, plain language, what page covers, what does it, you're always going to have this frustration when problems occur. Now, Mother Nature, no one can cover it, okay? If it happens, it happens. And they're difficult times. People are in trauma. They're in pain. They're in shock. But I have witnessed these floods in Delaware County from 2004 to 2012. I visit every town that has the devastation. And it amazes me, the spirit of the people. They get up and they stay there and they try to rebuild. But it's not working, the flood insurance. It's not working. And it may be bigger than us. You know, the answer may resolve in Congress. I know our superintendent is doing the best he can, or he'll try to do more. And this adjust the process, that seems where we can make a turtle step in improvement. But there's still fundamental problems in the FEMA process that is not getting it done. And I think overall, we need more transparency in policies. That has nothing to do with flooding. That's what I'm seeing as trends, getting worse, not getting better. And I thank you all for being here. You're not the enemy. It's just that we have common problems, and constituents are suffering. And, you know, you can only see the pain so much. And people have walked away from their homes. In fact, take Senator Seward's district. Up in Prattsville, village is gone. 10% population went down to Catskill in Greene County, just walked away from their town. It just, there wasn't enough help. And Margaret, we can go all over, Binghamton, Schoharie, we see it all the time. And I'm not saying that you have to indemnify for Mother Nature, because you have contracts and you have risk and premium versus your risk. But we can be more honest in our policies. We can say it more plainly so that consumer knows what they're getting and what they're not getting. And I thank you all for being here, by the way.
If I could just stress that, because actually FEMA has, we do have a pay summary exactly as you described, and whether it could be better, whether people could be encouraged to read it closer. But we have, I just want to say that we have taken that type of comment that we received in the past, that we need to try to set out exactly what's covered and what's not. And we've been doing that now for 5 or 6 or 7 years.
6 years.
Okay. So we have made those kind of efforts. I also wanted to reiterate, because that's actually what half of what you said is part of what our first conversation that the Federal Insurance Administrator and I came up to meet with the superintendent and Marty. And what was important to us is that we have our various roles and we have various oversight and the state has a role. But we are trying to do the thing to make sure that people get what they're entitled to. Look, personally, we all work for FEMA for a reason. I used to work for a big law firm, and you know we came to FEMA because most of my fellow workers because it's important to us. It's important to have to do something that has some meaning that helps people. We're not the people who are trying to we're not trying to not pay people what they're entitled to. We don't have a profit motive in this. We are, you know, seriously, as a people of FEMA, we want to be your partners in this because we really are trying to. That's why we're there. So I appreciate what you're saying, honestly.
Well, look at the trends. We see New York, we talk about flooding. You're having more natural hurricanes and weather changes and flooding across the whole United States. I mean, it's a bigger problem than New York. It's a country problem. And it's in Congress's lap. And we see some of it on the flooding side. And I'm just seeing where it's not working here. And I know there are bigger problems that have to be resolved. But I'm just saying we all have to work collectively to try to do a better job in getting our arms around these problems. Not that they're going to go away, but we can try to alleviate some of the pain. That's all.
Senator. As we draw to a close, begin to draw to a close, we'll give everyone, if you have one final parting comment, we'll give everyone that opportunity. But I did have one quick question in terms of the assuming the process goes well and there's actually going to be a payout to a policyholder. Now, I've had situations where people are not in their house, but yet their check gets mailed or FedEx to the abandoned property. Is in terms of the payout, is there a way to do that electronically? Is that an option in under the program that the carrier can make the payout electronically to someone's bank account versus having to be sent to a physical address? Because I've had problems associated with that.
Yeah,
people have talked to me. They've had their check. Or it's been left with their neighbor, also an abandoned house. They've had to go and get it in the dark at night because when they tracked it through FedEx, that's where the check went.
Senator, you made a great plug to have an agent. We tell them to send it to their agent, and the agent knows where the insured is, and we deliver it. Thank you for that plug.
Yeah,
I didn't know what the payout options were. I mean,
when we have a claim, the first thing we ask when they call the claim, and we ask the insured, what's your most recent contact address and phone number? And then we do follow up to make sure that we get the most current. But unfortunately, and I can only reference Katrina because that one was a major issue with that. People moved around so much. But yes, we can overnight. If we have routing numbers, we can route to their bank accounts. We try to make whatever is possible.
So those options are out there.
Yes, sir.
Yes, they are.
Okay.
I'm glad those options are there because I had one individual whose house was condemned, couldn't be there. We gave the company the address, this temporary location, and after the period of time, they went through. As frustrating as that was, and devastating as that was, they said we're going to send you a check. Didn't get it. We finally called back. Again, it was mailed to the house that was condemned that nobody was living at. Apparently sent back. Then we actually had a new check made for him. When he received the check, it was the wrong amount. Had to go back and have a second check reissued sent to him. So that your point of having it electronically transferred, I think, is very important and very helpful. But in a case like this, they knew where the temporary address was and still didn't get there appropriately. It's just a time lag from when you give it to the adjusters till it gets back to the home office. I'm really not sure exactly what happened. But I just want to go back. My personal experiences as an agent, all the issues that everybody has talked about around this table, we've experienced all of them. And I can give specific details at a later time if somebody would like those. But I do agree with Mr. Cherry that if the claims process was better and easier, you would sell more of it. The FEMA would sell more of this. We were flooded in 2006 in our area. And since that, well, even before that, but since that time specifically, we have done everything we can to talk to people about buying flood insurance, whether you're in a flood zone or not. Unfortunately, this time it was worse than 2006. And a lot of those people that we had talked to did not buy insurance, said, well, you know, I had conversations with so-and-so, and they had such a problem with the flood insurance recovery that I just didn't think it was worth it. So I agree 100% with Mr. Cherry that would make life a lot easier for everyone.
Senator?
Yes.
Just to add a little context from the local county emergency management side. I'm from Orange County, which is in the southern portion of the state. We've experienced flooding, significant flooding in 2004, 2005, 2006, 2007, 2010, and now 2012. So we're very, very versed in flooding. Fortunately, many of our residents that do flood have flood insurance. But to give some context to this storm, we had 192 roads closed in the county. We lost 9 bridges. We lost 2 dams. We had thousands of people in shelters. We lost 2 water treatment plants. We had thousands upon thousands of people apply for individual assistance under FEMA. We had more people apply for individual assistance in Orange County than most of the rest of the state combined. What that tells me is that, as it was stated here, that most people didn't have flood insurance, that needed flood insurance. We saw water where we never saw water before. Creeks that even in major flooding events turned into rivers. I mean, we had something along the lines of 30 inches of rain between the end of July and the beginning of October. No creek, no stream, no water table can take that amount. Even my own house was flooded, and I'm nowhere near a creek because it just came up right through the rock into the basement. So I would applaud to any effort we could make in order to educate the public and what's available out there. And as Senator Bonisek said, to make it as plain language as we can, because after a flood, we often get the phone calls and people get caught in between FEMA and the insurance company. FEMA will cover this, insurance company will cover that. And there's a lot of questions, especially in those first month or so, that a better education effort before and after an event would be greatly helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we are drawing to a close. We are not serving lunch, so we're going to be drawing to a close, even though we're sitting around the table. Does anyone have a
one parting shot
here?
Yes. Thank you very much for this forum, dialogue, bringing the industry together, focusing on this, and having the regulator here also. I think we're going to have good things in New York after this. Last question, maybe privately, you could tell me, or publicly. We had some members reporting to us that they had approved, they were denied on the homeowners to get paid by the flood. And I don't find that anywhere in any policy form.
Yes, that's true. I had to submit a letter of denial from the homeowners policy because I submitted, CEFQ, the agent submitted claims to homeowners as well as NFIP, and we had to get the letter of denial. I don't think it was for NFIP, it was for FEMA. You had to submit a letter of denial for to apply for FEMA assistance.
Oh, it's for FEMA. Okay.
I believe so.
If I may, thank you very much, Senator, for having this meeting, and Superintendent for being here. We really appreciate that. We, as an industry, PCI, and I'm sure I can speak for most of the industry as well as hopefully for FEMA in this regard, we certainly want to work with you all to make things better. You know, as every one of these disasters proves up, there's always something that can be learned. And we've learned some things here today, and hopefully those are some things that we can all have a personal stake in making better for the citizens of New York.
Thank you. Anyone else?
Can I just add one thing?
Sure. I think the danger with these always is we tend to focus on the problems, right? It's not interesting to sit around and talk about the claims that got paid on time. And I think for the most part, the industry did quite a good job after the hurricane, and I know, but it was our job collectively at the time to help the people who weren't getting service properly. So I just wanted to, there's that dichotomy there, and it doesn't mean you're the bad guys. It doesn't mean you're not doing a good job in 95% of the cases, and that's really what it seemed like. Most people were getting paid, and it went quite well. And there are many wonderful stories of people who got service right away, and you just don't hear about them because they don't make good copy. That said, you know, there are some improvements. I think you all can make. There's some improvements we can make, and we're going to work hard to do that and look forward to working with you. And lastly, just thank you, Senator. This was a great time to hold this at a time when we don't have any storms and think about and get ready so when the next one comes around, we'll really hopefully be better prepared. So thank you on behalf of the governor.
Well, thank you for your participation and everyone. It's well said. I think a lot of things some went well, but some things did not go well. And we are looking to make some improvements wherever possible. Obviously, on the adjuster issue, that single point of a contact, you know, for a claimant, adjuster, perhaps better training here. If we're experiencing more floods up this in this part of the world, we do need to have a better trained cadre of adjusters there to help. Obviously, more education, spreading awareness among our constituents, more transparency, plain language, all of those things. And as we look to our federal representatives to give some long-term stability to the flood insurance program, we can communicate some of our ideas and thoughts to them as well as they go through that process. But this has been a good discussion, and I appreciate everyone's participation. Thank you all very much.